Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Through the Liquor Glass by Sarah Fox. Narrated by Hannah Cabell. Chapter 1. When I entered the town hall, I didn't expect to walk into an autumn wonderland. It was as if I'd stepped into another world. Outside, most of the leaves had already fallen from the trees, and the cold bite in the air suggested that winter wasn't far off. Here in the town hall, however, fall was still in full swing, and there was a magical fairyland quality to it. A latticework archway curved over the doorway that led from the vestibule to the main room. Yellow and orange sunflowers had been affixed to the arch, along with garlands of fall leaves and white fairy lights. The flowers and leaves were all artificial, but the archway still looked great, and from a couple of feet back, it was hard to tell that the decorations weren't real. The doorway was only the beginning. In the spacious main room, the decorating committee had gone all out. Strings of orange and white lights stretched across the ceiling, and tablecloths in autumn colors covered the folding tables set out along the perimeter of the room. Rustic lanterns filled with microlights adorned the tables, while bales of straw, pumpkins, and gourds decorated the corners of the room and the spaces between some of the tables. Although the decor as a whole impressed me, what really drew my eye was the maple tree in the middle of the room. I didn't know for sure what it was made of. Papier-mâché, maybe. But it stood at least twice as tall as me, its branches reaching right up to the ceiling. Fake leaves graced the branches, which were also strung with lights. Whoa! Booker James stopped short when he entered the room, a pumpkin held in each of his muscular arms. It's like fall exploded in here. I'll take that as a compliment. Mel Costas joined us in the room, gazing around with a satisfied expression. Mel worked at my literary pub, the Inkwell, but she was also a talented artist and had volunteered to head the decorating committee for our town's first annual food and drink festival, A Taste of Shady Creek. It's definitely a compliment, Booker assured her before addressing me. Where should I put these pumpkins, Sadie? I turned in a slow circle, reading the banners hanging from the tables until I spotted the one designated for my pub. Right over here. I led the way to the table and set down the box I was carrying. Booker placed a pumpkin at each end of the table. He worked at the Inkwell, too, as a chef, and he'd offered to help me transport a few items from the pub to the town hall. From my box, I unloaded some gourds and a vase holding a bouquet of dried flowers in fall colors. Then I removed a smaller box full of Inkwell fridge magnets and a stack of postcards that featured a photo of the Inkwell on one side and a partial menu on the other, listing some of the literary-themed food and drinks available at the pub. I'd be offering samples of a few drinks at the table, but I wanted festival goers to know that they could enjoy a wider variety of options if they stopped by the Inkwell. Mel expertly arranged everything into a nice display while I tucked the box beneath the table, where it was hidden from view by the tablecloth. The box also held cups and napkins, but I wouldn't need those until the event officially opened the next day. Voices drew our attention toward the door as several people entered the room. Hey, Mel, got a minute? A woman called out. See you guys later, Mel said to me and Booker before jogging across the room. I surveyed the table. I think that's it for now. I glanced Booker's way and realized he wasn't paying any attention to me. He was taking in the sight of the room as a whole, a far-off look in his eyes. I nudged his arm with my elbow. Everything okay? His attention snapped back to the here and now. Everything's great. Do you need help with anything else? No, that's all for today, I said. Thanks for lending me the use of your muscles. Booker grinned. Anytime. See you at the pub. He set off out the door. I took a moment to admire all the decorations again, and then followed in Booker's footsteps. By the time I got out the front door of the town hall, he was already out of sight. I still had a couple of hours before I needed to open the pub for the day, and I knew exactly how I wanted to spend that free time. I walked across the village green, enjoying the fresh, crisp air and the hint of wood smoke carried by the slight breeze. Although I wasn't eager for the temperature to plummet, as it no doubt would when winter arrived. I found something to enjoy about every season here in Shady Creek, Vermont. Autumn brought stunning colors, evenings cool enough to snuggle up in front of a fire, and the town's annual autumn festival. That event had already passed, but now there was a Taste of Shady Creek to look forward to, as well as Halloween, my birthday, and my mom's first visit to my adopted town. When I arrived at the Village Bean, I waved to the owner, Nettie Jo Kim, and got in line behind two other customers. While I waited, I noticed that Nettie Jo wasn't her usual relaxed self. She kept darting glances toward the back of the coffee shop while she served the customers at the counter. When it was my turn to place my order, her smile was strained. "Hey, Sadie," she greeted as she shot another glance across the room. "What can I get you?" I looked over that way, but couldn't tell what kept drawing her attention. There were customers seated over there, but they didn't seem to be doing anything that wasn't expected from customers at a coffee shop. "Two large lattes, please. One pumpkin spice and one pistachio." Nettie Jo gave me a more relaxed smile and grabbed two cups, less distracted now. "Got a date with Grayson?" She knew that my boyfriend loved her pistachio lattes. "Not exactly," I said, "but I'm going to stop by the brewery." Grayson owned the Spirit Hill Brewery, located next door to my pub. I paid for the drinks and then wandered down the counter to wait for them. It didn't take long for Nettie Jo to set them in front of me. I thanked her, and then noticed her dart another glance toward the back of the shop. "What's going on?" I asked quietly. "You seem uneasy." She grimaced. "Maybe a little nervous." She discreetly tipped her head toward one of the tables, where a dark-haired woman sat on her own, her attention focused on her phone as she sipped at a hot drink. "That's Dominique Girard," Nettie Jo whispered. The name didn't ring a bell, and I'd never seen Dominique around town. "Should I know who she is?" I asked. "She's a food writer, pretty well known in New England. These days she writes for Foodie Fair." I'd heard of the magazine, although I'd never read it. "She's in town for the festival?" I guessed. Nettie Jo shrugged, her gaze on Dominique. "Most likely, but at the moment she's right here." "And you want to make a good impression?" I figured that was a safe assumption. "I'll say." A blast of cool air tickled at my skin as someone entered the coffee shop. "Oh, no," Nettie Jo said under her breath, her gaze on the door. "What is it?" I asked. A man I recognized but didn't know had just come into the shop, but I couldn't see any reason why that was a cause for concern. Without answering my question, Nettie Jo scurried along the counter to greet the new customer. "Hi, George," she said with what sounded like false cheeriness. "What can I get you today?"
"A large black coffee,"
George replied. He was about to say more when he clamped his mouth shut and stared hard at Dominique. Alarm flashed in Nettie Jo's eyes as George's face flushed. "Ignore her," Nettie Jo whispered, sounding desperate for George to listen to her. If he heard, he didn't heed her advice. Apparently forgetting about his order, he marched over to Dominique's table, his generous cheeks now a worrying shade of red.
"You," he spluttered. "You dare to set foot in this town?"
Dominique looked up from her phone, her expression one of mild surprise. "Sorry," she said, completely unruffled. "Do I know you?" George's face flushed even more.
"You're not welcome here," he bellowed. "You ruined my life, and now you think you can waltz back into this town like you own it?"
Dominique remained composed. "I'm simply trying to enjoy a cup of coffee." Nettie Jo darted out from behind the counter and grabbed George's arm, trying in vain to tug him away from Dominique's table. I was afraid that George was about to have a heart attack or stroke. He really didn't look well. His red cheeks were almost purple now.
"I'm afraid you'll have to leave, George," Nettie Jo said, tugging his arm again.
George shook her off and was about to yell at Dominique again when a woman's voice drew our attention.
"What's going on here?"
A tall woman strode into the coffee shop. "George?"
"Oh, thank goodness you're here, Miranda," Nettie Jo said, her relief almost palpable.
Could you please get your husband to leave my other customers alone?
When Miranda got close enough to see Dominique, her brown eyes hardened.
You, she seethed.
Nettie Jo's expression of relief vanished. She squared her shoulders.
All right, that's it. George, I won't ask you again. You need to leave.
She turned to his wife.
Miranda?
Miranda glared at Dominique, but she took her husband's arm and guided him toward the door. Come on, George. It's not worth wasting our time on her. The two of them stormed out of the coffee shop. Nettie Jo blew out a breath and looked around her. All eyes were focused on her and Dominique.
Sorry about that, everyone, Nettie Jo said, attempting to smile.
She wasn't very successful. As the other customers turned back to their drinks and snacks, I edged closer to Nettie Jo and Dominique.
I'm so sorry, Nettie Jo said to the other woman. Let me get you a refund for your drink.
Thank you, but that's not necessary, Dominique assured her. I really don't remember that man, but I'm guessing he must be a chef or a restaurant owner.
Former restaurant owner,
Nettie Jo confirmed. Ah, I can figure out the rest then. Thank you for defusing the situation.
It's the least I could do.
Dominique turned back to her phone, so Nettie Jo left her in peace and headed toward the cash register. No one was currently waiting to be served, so I rested an arm on the counter and leaned closer to her.
What was all that about?
I asked in a low voice. Nettie Jo sighed as she wiped down the counter.
George Keeler used to own a restaurant here in Shady Creek. Dominique came to town a few years ago and wrote an unflattering review of his establishment. Not long after that, his restaurant went bust.
Ouch.
Nettie Jo nodded.
As you witnessed, he still harbors a grudge.
A group of three customers bustled into the coffee shop, laughing and chatting. Nettie Jo cast a nervous glance in Dominique's direction.
Hopefully, today's drama won't give her a bad impression of this place.
I doubt it will, I said. You handled the situation well. The newly arrived customers lined up at the counter, so I let Nettie Jo get back to work. On my way out the door, I crossed my fingers, hoping for Nettie Jo's sake that what I'd said about Dominique would turn out to be true. Chapter 2. With my drinks in hand, I continued on my way to visit Grayson. After crossing Creekside Road, I followed the long driveway up the hill to the cluster of brewery buildings. Even though it was barely mid-morning, the parking lot was already more than half full. I didn't doubt that it would soon be packed. The Spirit Hill Brewery had enjoyed great success in the time that I'd known Grayson, and the business had prospered even more ever since the brewery was featured on the television show Craft Nation. With the food and drink festival about to start, Grayson would be even busier than usual. I hoped I would have a chance to do more than simply hand off his drink to him today. I'd barely seen him so far this week, and when I didn't see him on a daily basis, I missed him terribly. One of the many signs that I was in love. I stopped in at the main office in case Grayson was working there, but his receptionist directed me to the tasting room, which was located in a building of its own. The spacious tasting room had high ceilings and large windows that offered a beautiful view of the forest. When I arrived in the building, I spotted Grayson right away. He stood behind one of the tasting counters, chatting with a middle-aged couple. Two of his employees were also busy offering samples of beer to eager customers. I caught Grayson's eye, and my heart gave a giddy skip when his face lit up at the sight of me. I nodded toward the display of merchandise, letting him know that I'd wander around until he could spare a few minutes. It wasn't long before the middle-aged couple made their way over to the display of beer for sale. Grayson tucked the used glasses out of sight, quickly wiped down the counter, and came over to meet me. He slipped an arm around my waist as we headed for the door. Pistachio latte, I said as I handed him his drink. My favorite, he said with appreciation. As soon as we were outside, he tugged me around the corner of the building, out of sight of anyone coming or going from the tasting room. He brushed his lips against mine. Also my favorite.
Fortunately, I managed to keep a firm hold on my latte when he gave me another kiss, this one much longer and deeper.
"What have you been up to so far today?" he asked, several blissful moments later.
It took a second to get my dreamy brain working again. "Not much, but there was some drama at the Village Bean. There's a food writer in town, and she and George Keeler got into an argument. Apparently, she wrote a negative review of George's restaurant a few years ago. Not long after, he had to close the restaurant."
"I remember hearing something about that," Grayson said. "It happened before I moved here."
I picked at the edge of the lid on my takeout cup. I hope the writer doesn't punish Nettie Joe with a negative review of the Village Bean because of George's behavior. Grayson echoed what I'd said earlier at the coffee shop.
"I doubt that would happen."
"What if she comes to the Inkwell? I don't want to end up in the same boat as George, having the place go belly up because she wrote a negative review." Grayson pulled me close and gave me a squeeze.
"That's not going to happen. Everyone loves the Inkwell, and the negative review wasn't what caused George's restaurant to go under."
"It wasn't? I got the sense that he thinks it was."
"Everyone always said that his restaurant would have gone bust anyway. I'm pretty sure the business was in deep financial trouble long before that review was written."
I digested that information. It eased my nerves, but didn't banish them completely. I swirled my half-finished latte around in the cup.
"Hey."
Grayson tucked my red hair behind my ear.
"Is the food writer really what you're worried about?"
"It's not all that I'm worried about," I admitted. He set his latte on a window ledge and pulled me close again. I rested my head on his shoulder.
"Let me guess," he said. "You're nervous about your mom coming to visit."
"A little bit," I confessed.
"Or maybe more than a little bit."
I sighed. "I really want her to approve of everything."
"Including me?"
I raised my head and smiled, putting a hand to the side of his face. "I honestly don't know how she couldn't approve of you."
"I am quite charming,"
Grayson said, with the grin that always sent butterflies fluttering in my chest.
"You are," I agreed. "And devastatingly handsome."
"I'm not arguing with you there." I melted into him as he kissed me. A burst of laughter startled us apart. A cheery group of tourists had exited the tasting room. I stepped back from Grayson as they reached the corner of the building and came into sight. "I'd better let you get back to work," I said with reluctance.
"Unfortunately."
Caleb Jollimore, one of Grayson's employees, emerged from the building that housed the brewery's offices.
"Hey, Caleb,"
Grayson hailed him.
"Do you have a minute?"
Caleb altered his path to head our way. I quickly gave Grayson another kiss and then took a step back. "See you soon?"
"Definitely."
I said a quick hello to Caleb and then left them to confer about some brewery-related matter as they headed toward the building where the brewing process took place. I'd barely made it halfway across the parking lot when Juliana, the brewery's public relations manager, came rushing out of the main office. She stopped when she spotted me. "Sadie, have you seen Grayson?" I pointed at the building over my right shoulder. "He and Caleb just went inside." "Thank you."
"Is everything okay?" I asked before she could hurry off.
"Great."
She glanced around and lowered her voice.
"I got word from the tasting room that Phoebe Ramone is here. I'm sure Grayson would want to know."
"Who's Phoebe Ramone?"
"A well-known food critic." Juliana was practically jittery with excited energy. "If we can make a good impression on her, it would be great for the business." She dashed off, calling over her shoulder, "See you, Sadie."
It seemed I was out of the loop.
Before today, I hadn't known about Dominique Girard or Phoebe Ramone. Maybe I needed to read more foodie magazines. On my walk to the Inkwell, I enjoyed the remains of my pumpkin spice latte, savoring the delicious flavor and the fall weather. The forecasters were predicting a series of storms in the near future, but for now the sun was shining and the color of the leaves that remained on the trees seemed even brighter than usual. Although I sometimes felt homesick for Tennessee, where I grew up, I couldn't deny that Vermont was beautiful, especially in the fall. In my opinion, the old stone gristmill that housed my pub and apartment was the most beautiful part of all. Silence greeted me when I let myself in through the front door of the Inkwell. Puzzled, I glanced at the time on my phone. Booker should have arrived for his shift already. Usually by this time he was busy with prep work in the kitchen, and he almost always sang enthusiastically up until the pub opened. Then he contented himself with humming or singing quietly. I made my way across the pub and pushed open the swinging door that led to the kitchen. Booker stood at the prep counter, tossing red cab of courage salad in a large bowl. "Hey," I greeted. "It was so quiet I didn't think you were here. Is everything all right?"
"Sure." Booker flashed me a smile. "I guess I'm thinking instead of singing today."
"Thinking about good things or bad things?" I asked.
"Good, I hope."
I found his response a bit cryptic, and that sparked my curiosity, which wasn't hard to do. Booker didn't seem eager to say anything more on the subject, however, so I left him to his work. I wandered around the main part of the pub, admiring the books I had displayed on the shelf that ran around the room, and making sure that everything was ready for the day's customers. I was straightening books on the shelf when Mel arrived for her bartending shift. Her electric blue and blonde hair wasn't quite as short as she usually kept it, and she had brushed it back instead of standing up in spikes. After she dropped off her jacket in the back, she stationed herself behind the bar, checking to make sure we had clean glasses ready for customers when they arrived. I was still straightening books and occasionally brushing my feather duster along the shelf. "Everything looks great, Sadie," Mel said. I stepped back and scrutinized the books. "My mom arrives in a couple of days." "And you really think she's going to examine every book for microscopic dust particles?" "No," I admitted with a faint smile. "Not quite." Mel came out from behind the bar and rested her hands on her hips. "Either she's going to like this place or she isn't. The alignment of the books on the shelf won't change that." "You're right." And I knew she was. "But I really want her to like it. When she sees how happy you are here, she won't be able to help but approve." I hoped that was true. My mom had never understood my decision to move to Shady Creek and purchase the pub. She would have preferred it if I'd pursued a more practical profession like dentistry or practicing law. Maybe this visit would help her understand that those paths weren't for me, that I was right where I wanted to be and where I was meant to be. Only time would tell. Mel flipped the sign on the door, and our first customers of the day arrived soon after. Getting settled into the rhythm of my workday helped to keep me from dwelling on my mother's impending visit. We were nearly run off our feet during the lunch rush, and even in the middle of the afternoon we had a decent crowd. In the evening, after Mel's shift ended and my other bartender, Damien Keyes, took over for her, business picked up again, to the point that I opened up the overflow room so there would be enough tables and chairs for everyone. I was so busy mixing cocktails, taking orders, serving meals, and clearing tables that I barely had a moment to pause for a rest. We were well into the evening, and I was busy mixing 3 Kiss of the Cider Woman cocktails when the front door opened and a woman stepped into the pub, bringing a crisp draft of air with her. My hand tightened around the bottle of dry apple cider I was holding when I realized that the newcomer was Dominique Girard, a well-known food writer in my pub. I reminded myself to keep breathing. Dominique surveyed the pub from a step or two inside the door. When she spotted a small vacant table by one of the windows, she threaded her way across the room and sat down. Damien headed straight over to take her order. I wanted to pull him aside and let him know who Dominique was before he approached her, but I didn't have a chance. Not that it mattered. Whether he knew who she was or not, Damien would treat her the same way he treated every other customer, and that gave me no reason to worry. I delivered the Kiss of the Cider Woman cocktails to the group of women who'd ordered them, and then I returned to the bar. 2 other customers asked for pints of beer. While I filled a glass with Sweet Adeline, a beer Grayson made from sweet potatoes and named for his late grandmother, my gaze strayed over to Dominique. Unlike at the coffee shop, where she'd remained focused on her phone most of the time, she appeared to be watching what was going on around her. I hoped she was soaking in the atmosphere and admiring the exposed stone walls and the gristmill's rustic charm. I was so busy wondering if that was the case that I yelped with surprise when beer overflowed the glass I was filling. Heat rushed to my cheeks. Fortunately, I didn't think anyone had noticed my blunder or my yelp. I quickly cleaned up the mess, pulled another pint, and safely delivered the drinks to the couple at the end of the bar. I really needed to focus. I thought I might be able to do just that until George Keeler walked into the pub. Chapter 3. George didn't notice Dominique right away, and that gave me a chance to draw Damien aside. Quietly, I told him what had occurred between George and Dominique at the coffee shop that morning. I got him up to speed just in time. George had taken a seat at a table with some friends, but as I watched, his gaze landed on Dominique and his eyes immediately hardened. A flush crept up his neck to his cheeks. Dread settled in the middle of my chest. I felt certain we were in for a repeat of the morning's drama. Fortunately, Damien had his eye on George and intercepted him as he got up and took a step toward Dominique's table. Damien put a hand on George's arm and spoke to him quietly. I wasn't sure what he was saying, but it got the desired result. George's face remained flushed, and there was a belligerent set to his jaw, but he turned on his heel and stomped out of the pub. Everyone else was too busy enjoying themselves to notice what had transpired. That included Dominique. Whereas she was watching the other patrons earlier, she was now focused on her red cabbage of courage salad and her secret life of daiquiris cocktail. Crisis averted. My shoulders relaxed with relief. "What did you say to him?" I asked Damien when he returned to the bar.
"I told him we didn't want any trouble, and I pointed out that if he caused a disturbance and we had to call the cops in, he'd be the one getting in trouble, not Dominique."
"Good thinking," I said, "and thank you." We very rarely had issues with rowdiness at the Inkwell, but on the couple of occasions when we had, they'd occurred in the evening when Damien was working. I was always grateful for his presence. Dealing with drunk and combative patrons, usually men, was my least favorite part of the job, and not one I was great at. Damien and Mel were both far more intimidating than me. Damien, while not particularly bulky, still had a muscular build, with tattoos on his arms. Mel stood a few inches taller than me and was an amateur boxer. Booker was taller than any of us and was a former college football player. I didn't doubt that he could toss someone out of the pub if necessary, but since he worked the afternoon shift, such a situation had never come up. So far. Relieved that trouble had been stamped out before it could truly ignite, I got back to enjoying my work. I chatted with customers and told tourists about the pub and the inspiration behind the literary-themed food and drinks. When Dominique was nearly finished her salad and her cocktail, I stopped by her table. "How is everything?" I asked her.
"Great, thanks," she replied with a smile.
"You're the owner, right?"
"That's right, Sadie Coleman."
I wondered how she knew I was the owner. Maybe she'd done some research before coming to the pub. If that was the case, maybe she was here for work, planning to write about the Inkwell. Nervousness jittered in my stomach. Her next words helped to put me at ease. "I really like the place you've got here." I beamed at her.
"Thank you so much."
"What inspired you to open a literary-themed pub?"
"My love for books," I said.
"I always had a dream of owning my own bookstore one day. Then, when I came to visit my aunt here in Shady Creek, this pub was up for sale. I fell in love with the building as soon as I saw it."
"I can see why," Dominique said. "You can't beat the charm."
My smile brightened further. It was an ordinary pub at the time, so I decided to make it my own by putting a literary twist on everything. A hint of heat touched my cheeks. I hoped I wasn't rambling. Fortunately, Dominique didn't seem the least put off.
"That's fantastic. I've always loved books, too. Now I'm passing my love of reading on to my niece. She wasn't much of a reader at first, but then I introduced her to Nancy Drew and the Babysitter's Club. Now she devours books. My best friend's daughter got hooked on reading thanks to Nancy Drew, I said. It's always so great to see that spark lit in a child.
Definitely, Dominique agreed. I reminded myself that she was a customer, not there simply to chat.
Can I get you anything else to eat or drink? I asked.
I'd love to try another cocktail. She picked up the menu from where it stood propped up between the salt and pepper shakers. I'll go with the Count Dracula.
Perfect for a chilly evening, I said. I'll get that for you right away.
I took Dominique's empty plate with me and dropped it off in the kitchen before mixing her drink at the bar. I combined blood orange juice with cranberry juice and simple cinnamon syrup. Then I added some coconut rum. As I set down the bottle of rum, my friend Cordelia King perched on a free stool.
How's it going? She asked. Are you all ready for a taste of Shady Creek?
I think so, I replied. Have you seen the town hall? It looks amazing.
I've heard that the decorating committee did a great job, but I haven't seen it for myself. I'll stop by the festival at some point, though.
I finished mixing Dominique's drink.
What can I get you?
A Milky Way gargle blaster and to be your nacho bee, please, she requested. I'm dying for all the cheese and saltiness of the nachos.
Her words made my mouth water and my stomach rumble. I hadn't had any dinner yet.
I'll have that for you in a minute, I said. I dropped off Dominique's drink and made sure she was still happy. I glanced over my shoulder as I walked away and saw her taking a picture of her cocktail with her phone. Excitement mixed with flutters of nervousness in my stomach. If she was going to write about the Inkwell, I desperately hoped she was enjoying the food and drinks. Doing my best to rein in my nervousness, I ducked into the kitchen to place Cordelia's order with Tegan, the chef who worked the evening shift. When I returned to the bar, Cordelia was facing the room, watching a woman who had just walked into the pub. She turned back to the bar, leaning across it to whisper to me,
"Do you know who that is?"
The slim woman had shoulder-length chestnut brown hair with bright red streaks. She wore expensive-looking jeans with a reddish-brown leather jacket and bright lipstick that contrasted sharply with her pale complexion. I'd never seen her before.
"No clue," I said.
"She tried to get a room at the inn, but we were all booked up."
Cordelia and her grandmother ran the Creekside Inn, which was housed in a beautiful Queen Anne up the road from the Inkwell.
Luckily, Shady Creek Manor had room for her. But you'll probably want to know what she does for a living.
She hesitated, reconsidering.
"Or maybe you'd rather not."
"Now you really have to tell me," I said. "Unless you want me to die of curiosity."
Cordelia smiled at that, no stranger to my curious nature. "She's Phoebe Ramone, a food and restaurant critic."
I recognized her name, having heard it earlier in the day when I was at the brewery.
"A Taste of Shady Creek is really drawing in the food writers."
Cordelia nodded.
"We've got another writer staying at the inn as well."
"Dominique Girard?" I guessed. She shook her head.
"I don't know her. Our other guest is Nick Perry. He's a travel writer. He's here to write a piece about Shady Creek as a vacation destination."
"Hopefully all this interest is going to generate some good publicity for the town."
"I'm sure it will," Cordelia said. "And for the Inkwell."
I held up my crossed fingers.
"You've got nothing to worry about," Cordelia assured me. "Anyone who writes about the pub will only have good things to say because this place is fantastic."
"Thank you." I appreciated Cordelia's confidence and hoped she was right, but I couldn't stop the nervous flutters that swept through me every so often. With both Dominique and Phoebe here at the pub, there was double the pressure to impress. Damien had taken Phoebe's order, so I didn't approach her, instead keeping an eye on her from afar. When Damien delivered a plate of paradise lox and a happily ever after cocktail to her table, she snapped photos of both, setting off another round of nervous jitters in my stomach. If she didn't like what she ordered, those photos could end up published next to a negative review.
"Stay positive," I admonished myself. She'll love the food and her cocktail. I crossed my fingers again. By the time Phoebe was halfway through her appetizer, I couldn't take it any longer. I wanted to say hello to her and hopefully let her see that the Inkwell was a friendly place. After delivering two drinks to a nearby table, I made sure that my path took me right past Phoebe. "Good evening," I said as I paused by her table. "I'm the Inkwell's owner, Sadie. How is everything?" "Great, thank you." She went right back to eating. I wanted her to be interested in the pub's literary theme, or anything about the Inkwell, but she was clearly more interested in her food than conversation. I didn't want to risk annoying her, so I moved on. Although disappointed, I tried not to take her reticence personally. She didn't want to chat, but that didn't mean she wasn't enjoying her time at the Inkwell. For all I knew, she was enjoying her food too much to talk. Or maybe she was busy composing a positive review of the pub in her head as she ate. I definitely wouldn't want to interrupt her thoughts if that was the case. I spent the next several minutes mixing cocktails for a group of 8 tourists who claimed one of the largest tables in the pub. They were food and drink enthusiasts and had come from Ottawa, Ontario to take in a taste of Shady Creek. In addition to checking out the booths at the town hall the next day, they intended to visit all of the businesses involved in the event. They'd already started with a trip to the Spirit Hill Brewery this afternoon. The next day, they'd also be hitting the Five Owls Winery and the local cidery. And the day after that, they hoped to check out the Caldwell Cheese Company and the local maple farm and sugar shack. This evening, however, they were relaxing here at the Inkwell. 2 of the tourists had ordered the Poirot cocktail, made from gin and cassis. One had requested the Count Dracula, like Dominique had, and another had asked for the Kiss of the Cider Woman, which featured locally made dry apple cider along with cranberry juice and ginger ale. The remaining members of the group had ordered pints of beer. Once I had all of their drinks delivered to their table, I headed back toward the bar. Halfway there, I stopped to greet Caleb Jollimore, whom I'd seen earlier in the day at the brewery. He and his younger sister, Alicia, had recently sat down at a small table near the edge of the room. I asked if they were ready to order, and they both requested pints of beer and burgers with sides of Lord of the Fries. I relayed their food orders to Tegan, and then took them their beers. Once their food was ready, I headed back to their table again. "You should tell Dominique what her comments did to you," Caleb was saying to his sister as I approached. His low voice rumbled with an undercurrent of anger. "And you can't let her ruin your dreams any longer. You need to start writing again." Alicia was about to respond, but when she saw me approaching, she snapped her mouth shut. She smiled when I placed her burger and fries in front of her, but the expression didn't reach her blue eyes. I thought maybe she was on the brink of tears. My suspicion grew stronger when she blinked rapidly and angled her face away from me as she tucked her strawberry blonde hair behind one ear. Caleb's smile also seemed half-hearted. Although I was curious about their conversation, I could tell they didn't want me to linger. I left them with their food, but I glanced back over my shoulder as I walked away. A stormy expression passed across Caleb's face as he stared across the room at Dominique. He clearly didn't like her, and his dislike for the food writer seemed to have something to do with his sister. But how could Dominique have ruined Alicia's dreams? I had no idea, and I didn't have time to dwell on the question, as I had several other food orders to deliver to waiting patrons. When I next had a moment to catch my breath, I cleared away Cordelia's empty dishes. She was no longer seated at the bar, but I hadn't seen her leave. As I was returning from the kitchen, she emerged from the short hallway that led to the washrooms. "Sadie," she took my arm and spoke quietly. "Phoebe Ramone is in the washroom having a spat with another woman." "Really?" I said with surprise. Cordelia nodded, her blue eyes wide. "They're really laying into each other. I'm worried it might turn into a full-blown catfight." That definitely wasn't good news. The last thing I wanted was to have to toss Phoebe out of the pub or, even worse, call the cops to escort her out. I couldn't imagine Phoebe writing a favorable review of the Inkwell if that happened. It might give Dominique a bad impression of the place, too. Still, I had to think about all my other customers. Damien was across the room, taking down an order for a group of four. I noticed that Dominique was no longer at her table. Maybe she'd already left the pub. "Could you let Damien know what's going on?" I asked Cordelia. She nodded and set off to intercept Damien as he came back toward the bar. I mustered up my courage and marched toward the women's restroom, hoping I wouldn't find fists flying and blood flowing. I could hear raised voices before I even got to the door. "I got the job because I'm a good writer," one woman seethed. The other woman let out a derisive laugh. "You really expect me to believe that?" "Jealousy doesn't look good on you, Phoebe."
"I'm not jealous."
I pushed open the door. Both women turned toward me. Dominique hadn't left the pub after all. Her eyes shone with fury, and Phoebe's expression wasn't much different. She had her hands clenched into fists, and her cheeks were flushed. "Is everything all right in here?" I asked, keeping my voice pleasant. Dominique shot a glare at Phoebe, but then glanced away. "Everything's fine." Phoebe relaxed her hands, but the tension didn't leave her jaw or shoulders. "Sure," she said. "Everything's great." The bitterness in her voice didn't match her words. Dominique brushed her dark hair over her shoulder. "Sorry for any disturbance," she said to me. Then she breezed past me out the door. Phoebe marched into one of the stalls and slammed the door shut. I backed out of the washroom. Dominique had already disappeared. Damien stood at the end of the hall. He raised an eyebrow in an unspoken question. "The situation seems to be under control," I told him. I described Phoebe so he'd know who'd been arguing with Dominique. "Hopefully they'll stay away from each other for the rest of the evening."
"I'll keep an eye on them," Damien promised.
I intended to do the same. As it turned out, I didn't have to worry about another altercation between Dominique and Phoebe that evening. Dominique had taken a seat at her table again, but her eyes widened when a blonde-haired man walked into the pub. He headed straight for the bar, while Dominique sat frozen, her gaze tracking his every step. When he perched on a stool at the bar, Dominique jerked into motion, pulling out her wallet and throwing some bills on the table before scurrying out of the Inkwell without looking back. A line from Alice's Adventures in Wonderland came to mind as the door drifted shut behind her. Curiouser and curiouser. Chapter 4. Thankfully, no further drama played out at the Inkwell that night, and by the next morning I'd pushed it all to the back of my mind. I focused instead on getting ready for A Taste of Shady Creek, which was starting that day. I mixed up several pitchers of cocktails and poured them into large thermoses, which I then tucked into a cooler. The festival was opening at 11, and I was running the Inkwell's booth for the day and part of the next. Zoe, my part-time employee and Tegan's twin sister, would be stationed at the town hall tomorrow afternoon while Mel worked at the Inkwell and I spent time with my mom, who was due to arrive in Shady Creek the next day. Every now and then a rush of nervousness skittered through me. I wasn't sure if it had to do with the festival, the food and travel writers who were in town, or my mom's visit. Probably all three. I told myself I was as prepared as I could be for the festival. As for the rest, hopefully everything would turn out well. Booker showed up for his shift a few minutes early so he could lend a hand with transporting the drink samples over to the town hall. Since I had two heavy coolers to carry, I was grateful for his help. I thought we could take one cooler each, but he insisted on carrying both. I would have struggled to do that myself, but for him it appeared to be no problem.
"Is it all right if I cut my shift short by half an hour this afternoon?" Booker asked as we walked across the corner of the village green. "I already checked with Tegan," he added quickly. "She's okay with coming in a bit early."
"That's fine," I assured him. "Is everything all right?" Booker had never asked to leave early before.
"I need to get to Rutland before the end of the day, that's all," he said.
Although my curiosity, or nosiness, made me want to ask the reason for his trip, I kept quiet. It really wasn't any of my business. Sometimes I was able to mind my own beeswax. We reached the town hall at the same time as Helen from the Five Owls Winery, which she owned and operated with her daughter, Katie. Booker and I chatted with Helen on our way into the main room of the town hall. Then we went our separate ways, Helen heading for a table on the opposite side of the room from the one designated for the inkwell. Even though I'd already seen all of the decorations, I walked slowly toward my station, giving myself a chance to take in the sight once again. The maple tree in the middle of the room was still my favorite part of the decor. I stopped beneath its branches and gazed up. I hadn't noticed last time, but there was a cute little owl perched on one of the branches and a chipmunk peeking out from a bunch of colorful leaves. Booker placed the coolers behind the inkwell's table and then returned to the pub to start his prep work for the day. I set stacks of paper cups out on the table next to some napkins. Then I nudged the fanned display of menus, adjusting one that had gone slightly askew. I didn't have anything else to do but wait for the event to open to the public. Fortunately, that didn't take long. Alma Potts, who'd helped organize the festival, opened the town hall doors promptly at 11. A small crowd of eager tourists had congregated on the front steps, waiting to get inside, so the festival got underway immediately. More tourists and several locals showed up soon after, and we quickly had a decent crowd. For the next day of the festival, I planned to offer a different selection of drink samples, but for today I'd brought Kiss of the Cider Woman, The Evil Stepmother, and The Secret Life of Daiquiris.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.